Hey, welcome back, and thanks for joining me again in another Microvellum Toolbox training lesson. Now, today I want to show you a little bit on customizing cabinets. So we have a customer that asked us to build something that's a little bit different than what we have in our library. So it's going to require going into the product and making some changes to the data. Along with working with just the local product, we're also going to learn how to add some more subassemblies and the way that we add them when you're using the foundation library. So let's open up a project and get into some more training. Okay, so we have this customizing cabinet project open. And this is what our customer wants us to make for them. But we don't ask questions. If they're willing to pay for it, then we'll build it. Well, this isn't something that's coming out of the foundation library as default. We got to go through and make some customizations. So pretty simple. Set of doors on the bottom, drawers on top. Weird cutout for the top shelf. Just our standard thin back, but you'll notice there that we have that additional nailer just to provide some more support. They did give us some exact dimensions to work off of, but in this video, we're just going to get it as close as possible and just so you can get the idea on how we can go through on making a cabinet like this. So to start, we just have our base open cabinet. Now you could use one of our other cabinets inside of this master cabinets category or the primary cabinets. And you could start with one of those with maybe a primary opened or something, but we can get to the same place also just working with our base open cabinet. So I haven't really done anything except change the height, turn on the finished ends, and made sure that we don't have an add countertop prompt turned on. And now turning that cabinet into the one our customer wants. So starting off in the prompts, we're going to go to our internal options. And the first thing we're going to do is add a center shelf. Because we want two bays, our drawer bay and our door bay, we need to give this cabinet a fixed center shelf. Component insert, this one is actually the bottom insert. And I know that because the prompt below is top component insert. So on the bottom one, we're going to do, let's go division with adjustable shelves. And then on the top one, we're going to go with just divisions. Now the center shelf position, I do want to adjust that because I want my doors to be larger than the drawers. And rather than just stomping on this formula, I'm just going to add a value of 6. I will just let this redraw and see what we got so far. Now, I am going to be working in a conceptual view during this, really just for personal preferences. But like it says, for the best drawing speed and performance, you might want to switch to a 2D wireframe. So now we have our two bays. On the top bay, I want to change it. I want that center opening to be a little bit wider than the one on the left and the right. So because that's now a subassembly, we're going to get there through our subassembly prompts. So under the modify and then modify subassemblies, show subassembly prompts. Make sure you're selecting on a subassembly to get this to work. And now it takes us into the prompts for those divisions. Currently, we have a division quantity of 2. If we wanted to update that, we can. We're going to leave that alone. We're just going to right click and show the calculators and update the width of that center opening to 15. For those other two, just check that box, equal, equal, and calculate. So that's all that we need to do for the divisions. We do have that rail notch on there. If you didn't want that on, you could turn that off here under the use rail notch. And if it was something that you didn't want on throughout the entire product or project even, then you can change your save options here. We're just going to save the subassembly to the product, so any other division's subassembly won't have that rail notch turned on. Now, because this subassembly was called division with adjustable shelves, it didn't have that rail notch to begin with. But anyway, moving on. We have our openings looking good. Before we start adding our subassemblies, I do want to make some more changes to the actual product. So now we're going to go into part properties, and we need to extend the left and right sides. So the way to do that is just going into the parts list on the right-hand side, selecting on that length value, and then we see this formula here. And I'm not going to do anything to the formula. I'm just going to add to the end of it. So we're just going to be adding 8 inches to all these parts. Make sure you hit apply formula. And now repeat the same step to the right finished end. For the base back, we'll also add 8 inches to that. And the base top nailer, we're going to make a copy of this one. And the part name, you can see we do have this formula down here. I don't need to keep that intact. So I'm just going to change the name, base mid nailer. Now you can take that nailer, right click, and copy that selected part. Now, because we stomped on that formula, I am going to have to go back and just change the part name to a top nailer so nobody gets confused as the parts with labels start making their way out to the shop. And our new base top nailer has a change in the Z origin now because the back extended 8 inches. So we're also going to raise the height of that nailer to be flush with the top of that back. Now let's save, close, and redraw and see what we got. Okay, so far so good. Got our extra nailer in there. Now one thing we need to do is add that top before we start adding our subassemblies. So let's go back into part properties. Currently we have our base top open grayed out with a quantity of 0. Because of the prompts that it's looking to, it's saying that we don't need that base top on, but I'm just going to trick Microvellum here and say that I do want a base top on. So just by adding that plus one at the end of the formula, we get our quantity one. And the width, I do want to change the width on this one. Currently, the width actually is going to be the overall depth of this countertop. And I'll just add 10 inches to it. 34 and a half. So that's going to be the inside width of our cabinet right now. But let's just say I want to go flush and I want to add another inch and a half. The best way to do this is adding a prop name that looks to the thickness of your parts. So by selecting this paste name, you can get a list of all the different variables, whether they be global variables, local, subassemblies, that you can choose to paste inside of this formula. Under the local variables, scroll all the way down and you can find some thickness prompts. There we go. We got thickness applied in, thickness back. What we're going to find is our thickness left side. Hit OK. And now we have plus thickness left side. So there's 3/4 of an inch or whatever the thickness of that left side is, plus the thickness of the right side. So we can just type this one in, thickness right side. And it doesn't have to have that L exclamation because we're already in that local workbook. You don't really need it. But if it's in there, it still works. So not a problem. Now we're up to our 36 inches in length. And because I want a 2-inch overhang on each side, I'm just going to add an additional 4 inches. So it's going to overhang the left and the right side by 2 inches. So we have our top length at 40 inches. Now to the origin and the rotation, the X origin, currently that's sitting inside of the left side of our product. So now we need to back that up 3/4 of an inch, or even better, the thickness of the left side. And because we want a 2-inch overhang, we're also going to go to the left in 2 inches in X. So we're always working from left to right when we're building these products. So if we want to move it to the right-hand side, it would be a positive value. But if we want to move it back to the left-hand side in X, it's a negative value. Now for the Z origin, we're just going to add 8 inches. And let's save and redraw. Okay, so a few things happen there. Obviously, we still need to work on the Y origin. And it looks like the Z origin, we also missed by 3/4 of an inch. I should take that back. It's not like we really missed it by 3/4 of an inch. It's just the way that the base point is set up on this part. So the red is referencing the base point. So as we went up 8 inches, it's still just to the top of that shelf. Now we don't want to change the base point or the machine points here. We just want to give it another value. So now what we can do is add another 3/4 of an inch, but using our thickness prompt to give us that value. So now we can use our thickness top prompt. And for the Y origin, though it's negative 22, the way that it works is 0 is the back of the cabinet, basically. And then as it moves forward to the front, it's moving in a negative Y direction. So because we still want this base point in the front, we added 10 inches to our countertop in depth. So this will still give us a 2-inch overhang on the back. I'm not too worried about those holes in the top right now. We can turn those off if we want by going into part properties again and digging into the machine tokens. There we have our bore 5 holes, and it's being controlled by a global variable called drill rails for countertop fixing. So two ways we can do this. We can delete our token directly from here, or just go into the global variables and turn off that drill rails for countertop fixing. But for now, we're just going to leave them on because the next thing we need to do is apply that machining to this top to give it that irregular shape. So what I like to do is start off by going into a top view, just UPL. We can keep the conceptual view on for now, that's fine, and then type in REC for rectangle. Make sure that we're snapping to the correct points. And because I have my 3D object snap turned off, I'm not worried about snapping to some of that 3D geometry. Changing back to a southwest view, you can see we have our rectangle on the floor. Now we're going to do our offset command. Offset that 6 inches. And then just stretch the top of this interior rectangle up to the outer one's midpoint. Now we'll use our trim command. And then finally join these using the PE edit command. Now that we have that joined, we can use our fillet command and type an M for multiple, change the radius, R, and then 2. Looks like I already had a 2-inch value on there, but that's all right. And just start adding a radius to each one of these corners. So that'll be the shape of this new top. Now, the reason that I drew it like this is because when we apply that machining, Toolbox lays the part down as if it were nested on the actual machine. So right now we're looking at the top of this part, but as it gets nested, because the face 5 is the interior, Toolbox is actually going to flip it over and we're going to be seeing this as it goes down on the machine. So let me show you what I mean. Let's open up 2D part editor. Go back into that other DWG, copy my polyline. Let's move it around, get it in the right spot. So that's what I mean about placing this polyline on the part in the way that it's going to be laying on the CNC machine. So we can go through 2D part editor and start applying machining this way. Go into our routing tools, selecting the correct tool, give it a depth, 0.75, tool comp, pick the existing entities, right? And then you can change anything else that you want. But instead of doing that, I want to show you another way that we can do it. If you haven't already seen some of our other videos on the 2D part editor, I suggest checking those out. But I want to show you how we can do this using our edit parts tools. So I'm just going to close out of this drawing without saving anything or updating the part. This part is still just a rectangular part, no machining, just to confirm. Now, if you go into the Microvellum palette under the Modify tab and then Modify Parts, we have this tool here that allows you to edit a part. Select on that top, and now select on the polyline. The positioning is just the same as it needs to be if you were using 2D part editor. So we got an error that says that this is not a polyline. Now, if I were to select it and then show properties, we can see that it is actually a polyline. But one thing that Toolbox likes when using this edit part tool is to make sure that this is actually called a 2D polyline when open up those properties. So one way that we can do this is just explode it, repeat our PE edit command, select all the objects, and now we're asked if we want to convert these lines to a polyline. Say yes. Now J for join. Fuzz distance, you can keep this at 0 and hit enter. The fuzz distance is basically looking to any break that could be inside of this polyline. Enter one more time. That's one way that you can make sure that it does turn into a 2D polyline. Edit part again. So by doing that, we've applied the machining to this top. Open up part properties and we can see inside of our machine tokens, there's our P-Line 5 machining token. You can also draw that part in 2D again. You can still go through your 2D machining tools and make any changes to this route. So for example, if you wanted to change the set mill, put that there, we do a lead in and a lead out. And if you make any edits, just go back into your parts list, select the part that you're working on and update that current part and redraw the product. Now, something to keep in mind when you're editing your parts using the 2D part editor or through the Modify Parts tools is that the cut part values are going to be static, no longer formula driven. If you're making any changes in the size of your product, you would have to go back into these values and also change those. So product is no longer parametric doing it that way. We'll pick up where we left off in our next video when we start working on those subassemblies. So that's it for now, and I'll see you on the next one.